What does that sound like? What is that kind of letting you know? Think about walking in the dark and then there's complete darkness. It's kind of hard to do that in the city because in the city, you know, we have a lot of lights and a lot of things going on. But try to do that out in the forest or out somewhere in the countryside where there's not a lot of light and you start walking in the darkness. What happens? Usually, you can't see where you're going. If it's pitch dark, it's very hard to see where you're going. And unless you have something that shows you a way of where you're going, you can end up in some form of danger sometimes or in a dangerous area or even potentially get hurt. I do remember as a kid, you know, running in certain areas in the dark, and I always seemed to trip over something or run into something. I think I remember one time running into a tree because I didn't see it. And it was just right there in front of me. But I just could not see because it was so dark. I've run into bushes when I was a kid. I did a lot of running around when I was a kid. Kind of a rambunctious kid. And we always played these games with friends and got chased around. And so I ended up with a lot of scratches and all sorts of things because I was running in the dark. And for some reason, we like to play a lot in the dark. That was kind of fun. But there was danger in that. And so that is something that what happens with us today. When they're talking about the darkness that exists, we're talking about the spiritual darkness. The spiritual darkness that exists in this world because of none other than Satan, right? And that is what's happening right now in our world. And that's why we are studying this particular study, which is a great controversy. You know, there is the battle, as they say, that's going on between two forces, if you want to call it that. And on one side you have the light, and the other side you have darkness. One side you have Jesus, which is the light, and on the other side you have Satan, which is the darkness. And, you know, that is revealed in the book of Revelation and throughout the scriptures, actually, not just in the book of Revelation, but the book of Revelation is a revelation of Jesus Christ. But it also reveals the aspects of what Satan is trying to do in this world, which is to keep individuals like ourselves and others away from the light, away from God, away from knowing how to get to God or how to believe in God. So it's one of the things that Satan does is a very common tactic is deception. For he is the father of lies, right? But Satan changes things. He changes his strategy as he's learned how individuals are able to do things or learn things or find ways to find the truth. Satan has found ways to change his method. But the one thing that has not changed is the result that he wants, which is to keep us all in darkness and to keep us away from God. So that's what this is all about. The great controversy is about that, about Satan prevailing and keeping us away, taking us down with him, so to say, so that we do not see the Father, we do not see God, we do not see the Holy Spirit and Jesus Christ as who they are. And a lot of times you see the different strategies that Satan has used over the course of human history to accomplish that goal. And this is what we're talking about here. But this lesson is to give us essentially hope, because that is what our belief in Jesus Christ is, right? It's our blessed hope that there is something better than the life that we have here. One that we do not have to worry about suffering, compromising, feeling pain, feeling sorrow, experiencing negative thoughts, negative reactions, negative things in our lives, not have to deal with the many aspects of life that draw us out and to bring hurt into our lives. Satan is the other one. He wants to kind of change the whole thing, the whole perspective of life, and I've talked about this before, as many other individuals have, that he wants to change the perspective that we have of God. As I mentioned before, a lot of times when you see things, even in our arena, in the legal arena, when something bad happens, they call it an act of God. And so that's the perception that Satan has used to have people think that, hey, when something bad happens, it's because God wanted it to happen and willed it to happen, so therefore it must be of God. And I know many family members that have that perception, and I've explained that before, that I had that perception when I was younger as well, that anything that bad that occurred or happened was because of God, and it's because of something I did, and I was getting punished for it, instead of now seeing God in a different way, in a way where he is trying to prevent that. God always gives us opportunities to not go that route, as they say, and that's why he is the shining light, because he says he knows this world is full of darkness, and he is the shining light that you can see your way out, or the way to, as they say. Sometimes we talk about there is a light at the end of the tunnel that we can see. So we can see that glimmering light and say, hey, let's go towards that light, because that light is good. Especially if any of you have ever experienced being in caves. We've done that as a family. Sometimes we've gone into these caves. And, you know, they have a lot of light, so we can see. But you know, as you start going down into these caves, it starts getting dark. It starts getting cold. And then you start wondering, it's getting a little, you know, some individuals feel claustrophobic when that happens. And you start thinking, wow, what if we go too far? What if the walls cave in? What's going to happen to us? And so imagine being stuck in the cave and not having any light, and it's completely dark. But if you see a glimmer of light, you're going to gravitate towards that glimmer of light, because you're saying, hey, that's probably my way out. And that is who Jesus is, the light, the way out. So in this lesson, we're going to be going over a few concepts, specifically, you know, the battle for the truth, the battle for the Word of God, and the battle for the mind. I kind of wanted you to keep those concepts in mind, because a war is won or lost, you know, battle by battle. That's what's happening right now. The overall thing is the war, right? And that is going to be ended at some point. But little by little, each and every day, we're going through battles. And our battles are to deal with the concepts of life each and every day. And when Satan loses, you know, he works different ways to bring down so many. And think about it. If we as created beings, as human beings, are here, and think of what Satan did in heaven when he had the celestial beings, the angels that were up there, and a third of those individuals or beings were lost because of the deceptions of Satan, and he brought them down. How much more can he do that to us? Think of that. Those angels were in the presence of God, yet a third of them were deceived. That is how strong the delusions that Satan puts out there are. Because he is a created being, but yet he was given so much. They talk about in the book of Isaiah, they describe Satan, you know, who he was. And that's why he was very powerful in what he said and what he did. And he was able to accomplish that. But now he is on earth, right? And so now he is working on who? Us. He wants each and every one of us, you, me, all of us. He wants to take us down. He says, well, I accomplished getting one third of the celestial beings. Let's see what I can do on earth. And I'm thinking he's doing a pretty good job. Not that I agree with it, right? But you start thinking there is so much deception that is going out there. But in order for us to prevail, we must cling to Jesus. For he is the truth and the life and the way. So why don't we go to Sunday's lesson? And let's start off there with some of the things that we deal with, I would say, on a daily basis a lot of times. So especially I have dealt with this quite often. You know, the title of Sunday's lesson is Compromise. Satan's subtle strategy. Compromise. How many have heard the word compromise? Nobody? I hear it all the time. I had to deal with compromise all the time. Compromise is essentially, for lack of a better word, is where you kind of give in. There are a lot of other words that you can use for compromise. Maybe you've heard the word agreement. But what happens for an agreement to occur? Most of the time you have to give up something, right? And so let's go to the verses that are described here at the very beginning of Sunday's lesson. It's in the book of John. There are two verses that we're going to be comparing, John 14:6 and John 8:44. So if any of you have your Bible open and would like to help us out here this morning, I can ask somebody if they want to read John 14:6 and then somebody else John 8:44. Does anybody want to volunteer to do that? Do we have a microphone that we can? Yeah, we do have a microphone. Okay, we have Brother Alvin. Let's see, Brother Alvin, if you can take John 14:6.
14:6. Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me.
Amen. So there you have it. Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. So he is saying he is the truth and the way and the life. Okay, so let's go to John 8:44 because it talks about us comparing these verses. So who's got John 8:44? All right, Sister Kizzy. Thank you.
It says, you are of your father the devil, and the desires of your father you want to do. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaks from his own resources, for he is a liar and the father of it.
Okay, so there you have the comparisons in the scripture of Jesus and Satan. You have one that is not only the truth, but it's the father of truth, which is Jesus, right? He says, I am the truth. And then you have a description of Satan, who is the father of lies, that all deception comes from him. He changes the truth. The lies produce what? Death in us. And that became very evident in their battle. If you remember, and when Jesus was going to begin his ministry, he was taken up and had to deal with Satan. And the Satan was tempting Jesus. What was Satan using when he was battling Jesus? Anybody? What was he using? Scriptures. I heard it. There you go. Don't be shy. He used the scriptures. So what does let you know that that Satan is very, very familiar with the scriptures. He's very familiar with the word of God. But the thing is that Satan has always done something with the scriptures. What has he always done? He's always changed it.
Twisted it,
yes, in a way that works on us. What did he do with Eve? Just think about that at the very beginning. He says, oh, I know what God told you, but it's not true. This is what will really happen, that you can actually become like God. And that's always been the thing that Satan has used, is to make each of us feel that we have no need of God. And that is where you have the big lie. That is the great controversy, is the truth versus a lie. So he's always worked on this. And compromising is kind of one of those things. In life, we're kind of used to compromising. But with the word of God, we cannot compromise. Because there is no other way for salvation than through Jesus Christ. But Satan's trying to say, not really. There's another way. There is another way. You don't need God. You can do it on your own. And that's why sometimes I was talking to somebody earlier this week. I just can't remember who it was. I had so many things happening this week. But we're talking about how sometimes even the twisting of works, doing works, right? So having faith and love and all of that for God results in good works, but other individuals will use the term to say, well, by works you will earn your way to heaven. Any of you heard that? I've heard that many times as well. And so that's just a subtle twisting of the words to make people feel like, hey, I'm doing good things in life, so I'm good. And I've heard that from many, many individuals, some close to me, that say, well, I'm a good person. I do good things, so I should be enough. And I'm like, well, the thing is, do you know Jesus Christ? Do you have Jesus Christ in your life? Because if you do, then the works come naturally. You don't do it to earn your way to heaven, but many times that happens. And so it's ways of compromising these words. And I remember this wisdom that I learned from an attorney many years ago. He's now a district court judge. But when I was in private practice, I had a great many cases, and sometimes, well, I shouldn't say sometimes, now it's required. The judges now require the parties to mediate, which is another way to say go and compromise, see if you can reach an agreement. And so I took a great many of my cases to this individual because he was really good at it. And I believe, if I recollect my, and all, I think I resolved all my cases except for one. But in order to be able to reach an agreement and to reach a compromise in many of those cases, he would end up talking to each side privately and then see if they could have some common ground and then work from there. And that's kind of natural, that what we do when you're trying to mediate cases or work or trying to reach an agreement. But one day when we were having a really, really difficult case, I mean, it was so difficult that we were there for hours, and it just seems like we weren't moving or going anywhere. He finally came to me and said, he goes, you know what, Julio? I need you to pay attention to something. And he goes, I learned this in my career, and I think it'll help you out. He goes, you know that the fairest result, and just mind you the context, right? Fairest result in this world, okay? So he says, the fairest result is when both sides leave unhappy. And I was like, what? How am I going to explain that to my client? He or she is going to leave unhappy. That, to me, as I worked in years later and looking at this now, makes a lot of sense. Because if you leave unhappy, that means you've given up something. But the essence of that is you leave unhappy. And do you want in your spiritual life to leave unhappy? That is the problem, and that's what Satan's trying to accomplish. And that's what the whole point of compromising was, I want people to be happy. And so let's let that happen and allow compromise to come into the world. And that's why when the church first came about, after Jesus had ascended, they were persecuted and followed. And so in order to not allow or have a lot of individuals get lost or killed, as they were, because many were executed, they reached a compromise. And I talked about this in last month, I believe, when I gave the sermon. I was talking about one of the first laws that was passed was a Sunday law, was one of the Roman emperors, and it was a Sunday law. So that was a compromise. Because they were trying to follow the pagan gods that worshipped on Sunday, but yet he wanted to have Christian people there, so they compromised and said, okay, let's go ahead and go and worship on Sunday, even though that was what they were normally accustomed to doing, with worshiping the pagan god. And so they compromise. And what has happened now? Do we have Sunday worship? Yeah. Most, if not all, the world is following that concept. And so you have seen, just with a subtlety, a form of compromise, how Satan over all this time has been able to accomplish so much. And that's one of the things that gets lost in this religious battle that is happening. And for some reason, earlier this week, I was watching some video, and one popped up, and it had to do with an individual that was essentially arguing with another one. And they were both of Christian faith. I don't want to mention the specific religions, but they were fighting, or, okay, they were not fighting, they were discussing, I'm being nice, with each other, and they could not agree on the divinity of Jesus Christ. And so I was just listening to this video and watching it, and I was just like, you have lost your way, my brothers and sisters, when you're doing that. I'm sorry? Yes, they were both of Christian faith. You know, just different denominations, but they were kind of like they were trying to battle each other, and they were pointing to scriptures. I'll give them credit, though. They were really good in memorizing the scriptures, but it was for their own need, right? It was for their own accomplishment. It was not, in my opinion, bringing any glory to God by them doing that. But yet, that battle went on, and just the battle on the divinity of Jesus was what they were doing, and they lost the whole aspect, like we should be doing here, that he is the shining light that leads us to God. And they're worried about, well, in John 1, you know, he was the Word, and the Word was with God and all that. And they were the one that says the Word was God, and they said, no. And this one, it says the Word was a God. And that's what they were fighting about, and it was because of the translation of the Bible that they were using. And I was just like, okay, this is just getting way out of hand. And that's what Satan wants. And that's what happens with this. And that's why we have to be very concerned, my brothers and sisters, as we go forward, that we do not compromise when it comes to the Word of God, that we do not lose our way, that we always focus on Jesus and the Word of God, because that's going to lead us to salvation. And so many times that's what happens, but it was curious to see that, and it was very unfortunate. It was saddening, actually, to see that, and that's what happens. And I'm saddened to see the so many denominations that say they believe in Christ, but yet we cannot agree on the things that lead us to Christ, and that's what happens. I think Sister Kizzy has something she wants to comment about. I know I'm going a little off the lesson study here, but because of an interest of time, I want to go ahead and go over a few things. But go ahead, Sister Kizzy.
Yeah, based on what you were talking about, I was just actually having a conversation with someone online who is of the Muslim faith. and she was quoting, she was basically telling me that Jesus is not God. He was created, and all of these things. And she was picking, she told me that I'm cherry picking some
yes.
scripture.
Common legal term we've heard many times in around the world, cherry picking, yeah.
Yes, and she told me that the Bible is laced with contradictions.
Laced with contradictions,
yes.
Wow.
Yes.
Okay.
And she was mentioning John chapter 17, verse 3. And so she basically cut off half of the, she didn't read the first two verses, but she cut off because she wanted to use it for her point.
There you go.
And I said, you know, what's strange is that you said that my Bible is laced with contradictions, but you're quoting from John. And I quoted from John 2, that same John 1:1.
Mm-hmm.
And then I also quoted from Revelation, which John also wrote, right?
Correct.
I said,
correct.
So if why are you using our book to quote and tell me that Jesus is not God, what I'm showing you. He's telling us that he's the
Danielle
Alpha
was excited.
He's the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. He is, you know.
That is right.
And I'm so happy that you mentioned it, because I felt like, wait, a minute, Julio. Are you telling me something here, too, that I shouldn't be having these conversations, too? But I understand, though, because, you know, we just have these conversations all the time, you know?
Exactly.
And what I was led to do was to continue to lift up Jesus, no
Amen.
Matter what. Because he is who he is.
Amen. And I don't want anybody to take it the wrong way. There's nothing wrong with having discussions with others. But it's what is the accomplishment of that discussion? That's what's important. And so, yes, cherry picking, that happens a lot. Many times individuals will pick just a half of the verse, but not read the ones before or the ones after to get the whole context of what was happening during that time frame. And that's what gets lost. I have no issues with individuals discussing their beliefs and all of that. But when it gets to the point where they're so focused on that one little word, well, it's the or a, and you're like, okay, we're getting so lost. And that's exactly what Satan wants, us to go down that rabbit trail, and that we get so narrowly focused on that that we lose out on the blessing of what we're supposed to be doing from God. And that happens so often, and I know that because lawyers do that all the time. They said, you know what, right here there's a comma missing, so that means something. You know, we get into those kind of things. Is it A or is it the kind of things, and that's where we get lost. And that's what Satan wants, and Jesus does not want us to do that. And, you know, on Monday's lesson, I'm just going to go over really in a broad stroke just what we're talking about right now. They're talking about savage wolves. And basically what they were talking about in there was there are going to be situations where we have individuals that we're going to get persecuted from outside of the Christian faith. And then you're going to have some that we're going to get persecuted from within the Christian faith, within our own church. And as you were saying, Sister Kizzy, that's going to happen. Those kind of things where we get narrowly focused on the small subtleties of things, the way we dress, what we eat, all those kind of things. Some individuals get so narrowly focused on that they lose the overall concept of who Jesus is and who God is, that he was one of love and mercy and wanted to see us all there. Because if you remember at the very end of the time he was here on earth, or I should say when he was getting crucified, he was crucified between two thieves, right? And so if we were worried about the way the thieves were dressed and the way they looked, you think that one of them would have made it to heaven and the other one not? They both would not have made it because they were up getting crucified for what? Because they were thieves. They were doing something they should have been doing that was wrong even in the eyes of man. Yet one was saved and the other one was not because one believed in Jesus and the other one did not. So, repent, that's right. The thing that John the Baptist always talked about, repent, for the time is coming. And so we can easily get lost in all these kind of things, and we worry about so many things, and we get lost in our own world, as they say, and we try to figure ways to make the scriptures fit our world or our life or our needs. And it made me think of, I did a presentation this week with some of the other administrative law judges in the state, and I was one of the presenters. And so we were going over some of the stuff and figuring out how to calculate certain things, and we ran into a cartoon that I saw. And I'm going to read what it is. It says, how many wrongs make a right? That was the question. And so this was the bottom of the cartoon. I'm just going to read it real briefly. It says, One individual, just picture two individuals on a chalkboard trying to write. And so they say, how many wrongs make a right? And so this is what it says. Yes, yes, I know that, Sydney, is one speaking to the other. He said, everybody knows that. But look, four wrongs squared minus two wrongs to the fourth power divided by this formula do make a right. And I call that lawyerly math. So that's what that is, my brothers and sisters. That's what we do in life, lawyerly math. We try to do all these kind of things to make it a right when we know it's a wrong. But that's our way, and that's what Satan wants. I should say that's Satan's math right there. That essentially We do this in life to compromise, to change things. But we do have a safeguard, right? The safeguard is the Bible. That's our safeguard. How do we test everything that happens in life? Through the Bible. The Bible is our guide. It's our strength. It's the light in the darkness. When you're looking for your way out, or you're stuck, or wherever it is you may be, go to the Bible. The Bible is the one that will find your way. It's the shining light that carries us out. It leads us to the truth, the Father of truth, which is Jesus Christ. So we can always be safeguarded by that. And don't get lost into all these things. You know, as Sister Kizzy was talking about, we're having those discussions. Even Bible scholars are leading us away. Because some of them are saying, well, yeah, it's not possible for us to predict the truth. Well, it is if we're inspired by God, right? I mean, after all, those that were in the past that wrote the books were like in the book of Isaiah, predicting the coming of Jesus Christ and what was going to happen. But if we believe some of these Bible scholars, we can get lost. And so we have to be concerned, as they say, with human reasoning, because our human reasoning will never comprehend God. And that's why God only reveals certain mysteries to us, because we're not yet ready to receive it all. It'll blow our minds to receive all of the truth at one point and at one time of all the things. And so in the very end, there is that battle, as I was talking about, the different battles that are happening, the battle for the mind, because that's where it's going to be determined. The battle for the mind is where it counts, my brother and sister, not just the heart, because they talk about the heart can be deceptive, right? Can we be deceived by the heart? Yeah, why? Because we get emotional. We're emotional beings. I mean, you say you carry your heart on your shoulder, and we can be very irrational when we follow our heart. How many times have we run into individuals that shouldn't be in a relationship, and they say, but I love him or I love her, even though they get abused or whatever it is, they're going to continue, but that's what happens with the heart. But with the mind, that's what Satan's after. He's already got the heart because he knows it can be swayed. But the mind is what he's after. And to change that, he changes the things in our lives. You know, occupying our mind with the things of life, appealing to pride, self-exaltation. You know, how do you feel when somebody pats you on the back, say, man, you did a great job? You start elevating yourself and like, wow, I can do really good. those are the kind of things that happen. We try to feel that we can earn our way to heaven and get lost in ourselves, and that happens a lot. We easily do that, and that happens in life. And the excesses of the body and the soul, you know. But most importantly, I think, my opinion, where we get lost, my brothers and sisters, and I think this is key, is we get lost because we start losing sight of what we're supposed to be doing, which is studying the Word of God. Like we should be doing here for our lesson study, right? We should be spending time studying our lessons, studying the Word of God. And when you start getting pulled away by the things of life and say, well, I'll do it later, oh, I don't have time right now, that's what Satan wants. That's what his accomplishment is. He says, I'm going to give you so many things to do that you're not going to have time to study the Word of God, and you get lost. And that's what he wants. He wants us all to get lost. And that's the battle for the mind, my brothers and sisters, that we get lost. But you got to remember that in the beginning, there was light. And who created the light? God. It's in Genesis 1, verse 3. Because there was darkness, and who brought the light? God. God brought the light. So now you know who is the Father of light, who's the Creator of light? God. God is the light. And that's who we should have in our life. So that way we do not get lost in this battle that goes on with each and every one of us in our spiritual life, in our existence, because it is the difference between having eternal life or eternal death. So, does anybody have anything they want to comment about? I didn't want to be preaching. Okay, Sister Kizzy, we got a few minutes before my time is up, or our time is up, I should say.
I just wanted to mention some things that on Thursday's lesson.
Thursday's lesson, sure, yeah. Battle for the mind.
Yeah, it says the battle between Christ and Satan is a battle for the minds of men. Satan's principal work is to blind or darken men's minds. He does this by keeping them from the study of God's word, by deranging the powers of the mind through excess of body and soul, by wholly occupying the mind through the things of this life, and by appealing to the pride and self-exaltation. But then I really like this next part here where it says, the lack of knowledge on the part of the lost is not because they could not know, it is because they would not know. Many have had the opportunity to know truth, but chose not to believe, and Satan blinded their eyes. Satan's kingdom is a kingdom of darkness. And I felt like this is so true, because even when having these discussions with people from other faiths, you can see there is a lack of knowledge, and we can see how people, their eyes have been blinded, and it's like, do you want the truth or you don't really want the truth? And it's a battle, you know, and I feel like this is really, really important for us to know that, and to understand that it really is important for us to keep our eyes focused on Jesus, keep studying his words, because as you rightly said, Satan, he is deceptive, and he's going to send people to talk and say things, and then we start listening and easily, quickly believing and starting to change and starting to make compromises. And that's where we fall into that trap. So in order for us, I believe, for us to not fall into that trap, we really need to keep our eyes focused on Jesus, keep our eyes on his words. And I think we'll be safe.
Amen. And I appreciate you brought that up, because there are the differences between having ignorance of not knowing the word of God, and then those where they know the word of God, but yet they choose intentionally not to follow it. And that's wherein we run into the situation. So there are individuals that are going to be out there that are lost because they do not know what's going on. They're still out in darkness and not have seen the light. But then you're going to have those that have seen, well, I've seen the light, but I don't like that color of light. I want my light. And that's what happens. And so sometimes we rationalize. How many times have you heard, well, you have your truth, I have my truth, they have their truth. It's like, no, there's only one truth. So luckily, you know, I've found myself in a position now in life where I'm looking and seeking the truth, and I want people to bring the truth to me. But at one point in my career, I was one that says, well, there's this truth. And then the other one said, there's that truth. And so we have to find a truth, right? But there is only one truth, and that is Jesus Christ, right? Because he says, I am the light. I am the truth. He didn't say, I'm a truth. I am the truth. And so let's just remember that. And so when we do have these kind of situations where an individual does not know, or they're lost because they don't know, well, that's our duty, right? Our duty is to spread the word, plant the seed, so they can learn about the truth. But those individuals that are lost because they intentionally choose not to know, or rather to ignore the truth, well, then that falls on them, because you've done your part. It's the Holy Spirit should work on them. And if they cannot, well, then they end up being lost because they have chosen to do that. And I know individuals that have done that. They know, like, well, I know about the Sabbath, but yeah, I can't do it because I'm used to going to church on Sunday, and I can't change. It's like, no, I've heard that many times. How many of you heard that? I cannot change. Yes, you can. You just don't want to. And so there it is, the desire. The desire is what controls there, and so they should change. But let us all pray for these individuals, my brothers and sisters, as well as for us, as we continue on this battle that happens with a great controversy. And hopefully we are able to reach our brothers and sisters that are out there that are lost, and show them the light. Show them the light through our life, through our words, through our actions, through our thoughts, but most importantly through the scriptures, in showing them the way to God. All right, so let's go ahead and end our lesson study so we can go ahead and carry on with our divine service and announcements. So Let's go ahead and do that now. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much once again for giving us an opportunity to come here and to study more about your word and to learn more about what you're trying to accomplish in this world and with each and every one of us, Lord. You are the light. You have brought in the light into the darkness, Lord, and you're showing us the way. You're showing us the way, the pathway to salvation, Lord, and that's what you want for each and every one of us, Lord. So continue to give us encouragement, strength, wisdom, and guidance, Lord, and give us the opportunities each and every day of our lives, Lord, to commune with you, to study your word, to grow closer to you, Lord, and to be able to learn from you what you want us to accomplish in our lives for your glory, Lord. And let us not forget who we are. We are to serve you, and our purpose is to accomplish your will with you and to participate in your accomplishment of that here on this earth, Lord. We thank you so much for giving us those opportunities. Forgive us of our sins and transgressions, Lord, and may all things be accomplished in accordance with your will. All these things we ask in the most holy, precious, loving name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Good morning. Happy Sabbath. Okay. All right. I know it's a little dark outside. Well, it was this morning. I see the sun is coming out now, so that's good. Welcome to worship. We're so glad you're here. Each of us have had different weeks, and by God's grace, he's brought us through to be in this place where we can worship him together. Amen. So a few announcements before we get going today. There aren't too many. There we go. So we continue to invite you to our Revelation Bible study on Wednesday at 7 p.m. Also Prayer Warrior on Sundays at 8 a.m. And there is fellowship breakfast with that. I really like anything to do with church that has food with it. That's how it was in the New Testament. The New Testament church, you read that they fellowshiped, they ate together, and that was evangelism for them. Sometimes we invest a lot of money in pamphlets and tents and all these things. They're not bad, they're not wrong, but the apostles in the book of Acts, they just ate, they prayed, fellowship, and the church grew, the Bible tells us. So we really invite you to maintain your faith throughout the week by engaging in these different things that we have going on at the church. No choir practice today. Today we'll continue. We're wrapping up, actually, our mental health series. So this afternoon we continue with part two of our topic today. I'll talk about that in a little bit. So at 6 p.m., what time? 6 p.m., let's be here. We also have food. So we have food after Divine Hour. We have food after the afternoon program. So this is a church where we fellowship and we eat. Amen. We will also have, let's see, what else did I forget? Our series that's coming up in September, the Trust Series. There we go. Every Sabbath from September 7th through October 26th. We'll be given more information, more specific information as the time grows near, but the idea is to make the Bible come alive. At this time, as my wife is coming to share an outreach project that we're working on, I want to talk about today's mental health topic. So today we're talking about suicide. And it's a difficult subject for a lot of people, especially if your life has been impacted by it. So we are aware of that. We're letting you know that's a topic we'll be talking about today. So be mindful of that, and if that's something that's triggering for you, definitely feel free to step out or do what you need to do to manage that. But just want to put that out there, that is the topic that we'll be presenting today. We'll be mindful that there are children in the audience as well, so we're not going to show certain images and certain things. But as part of our mental health series, for the topic, that's what we'll be dealing with today. So now I turn it over to my wife, who has an outreach project that she wants to talk about.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. So yes, we are a church who likes to eat a lot, as you can tell, but we're also a caring church. And I want someone to look up this verse for me, 1 John. And if someone can take a mic to them, that would be wonderful. 1 John 3:18. 1 John 3:18. Who can read that? Okay, Sister Aleman raised her hand. Go ahead.
My little children, let us not love in word, neither in tongue, but in deed and in truth.
Okay. Dear children, let us not love with words or speech, but with actions and truth. With what? How should we love? Action. Actions and in truth. And it's one thing to say, oh, I love you. I love you. That's wonderful. I'm going to pray for you. That's wonderful. Let's continue to pray always. But we also need to go above and beyond. This is how we show our true love. So we have a chance to do that. Our next outreach project involves the Human Respite Center. So we're going to partner with Catholic charities. They serve migrant families who are crossing the border. These are families in crisis. They're refugees, and their most basic need is, believe it or not, undergarments. Something that we take for granted. Undergarments. Panties for women, underwear for men. Because one of the things that they say is, you can wear the same outfit 2 and 3 days in desperate situations, but you can't wear the same panty, you can't wear the same underwear. I mean, we're talking about human decency, a sense of worth, right? So we're hoping to visit there. We're going to talk about those details where we can give them our gifts of love. We have some donations. These are for the children. These are for the women. There are several of them. And you're probably saying, well, why is she showing us this stuff? We know what underwear looks like. There's excitement to it. There's excitement to seeing this stuff here. And there's excitement to seeing an empty box getting full. So all it requires is that you go anywhere, Walmart, Target, downtown McAllen. That's where I went. I like there because you get really good prices. These are $2.99. And they're nicely individually wrapped, okay? So, and if you can't, ask someone to go. I could even go for you. If you cannot, you give me the money, I'll hand you your receipt. That's what someone did, and we'll make it happen by God's grace, okay? Let's pray for this. Let's pray for our migrant families. It really is a beautiful, I wish I could talk more, but I know that we're on time crunch here, but if you have any questions about this organization, I'd love to talk to you about them. They're in McAllen downtown, and they're called the Human Respite Center. God bless you. God bless you.
Amen, amen. Again, welcome. Our service is a little bit different today. We're also going to be translating in Spanish live, so we've cut a few things. So as our praise and worship team comes up to lead us in song, just want to really encourage you and thank you for coming out, and pray that God will give you a special blessing today. Again, for those of you who just came in, the topic is going to be a little bit serious today. We're talking about suicide. So if that is triggering for you, just want to put that out there. Be mindful of that. And I'm mindful as to what I present because I know they're kids. But again, just wanted to put that out there. May the Lord bless you today. I know he has something in store for each and every one of us. And we'll now turn it over to our praise team. Thank you.
We are going to be singing hymn number 99, God Will Take Care of You.
We have this hope.
We have this hope that burns with
So can you please stand as we do the doxology?
Is it his holy
wonderful, merciful Savior. We are so thankful, Lord, for this day that you've created in time so that we may pause the things of this world, Lord, our work, our troubles, our trials, Lord, and to spend time with you, to connect with you, to reflect on your power of creation, redemption, and restoration, restoration of our hearts, our minds, our souls. Bless us, Lord, this day, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning and happy Sabbath again. We want to welcome everyone who is here this morning, whether you are here in person, excuse me, or whether you're watching online. Welcome to God's church. We hope that you are blessed. We're very happy that you are all here, and my prayer and hope for you is that God speaks to you, God speaks to me this morning. You may all be seated. At this time, we're gonna do, as customary with our mental health series, each one of you should have had got or received a raffle ticket on your way in. So we're gonna draw those tickets now. So if you are the winner, please come forward. We have four gifts. Feel free to choose one of your liking. So we're gonna start with our visitors this morning. Is there anyone here that needs translation, by the way? ¿Hay alguien que necesita traducción en español? ¿Sí? Okay. Okay, está bien. I'll do both. All right. La primera es, the very first one is Michelle. Welcome, Michelle. Come forward, please. Let's give her a hand. All right. Welcome to our church. I've seen you before. You've been here several times, right? Yeah, come forward. Like I said, feel free to choose any gift. And I don't need the ticket back. Okay? You're welcome. And our next one is Ed. I know Ed because I met Ed. Ed, come forward. Congratulations. Felicitaciones a Ed. Sí. Puedes coger una. Yes, you can take one. All right. Now it's our members' turn. And let's see. By the way, Ed, where are you visiting us from again? So Ed is from here. He's visiting us. He's been here before, and his family member is from West Virginia. So let's make sure that we say hello to her later on today. Thank you for visiting. Gracias por visitarnos. Okay, Alvin Santiago. Yes. Congratulations, Brother Alvin. And our very next one is Hermana Norma Fleitas. Let's give Sister Norma a hand as well. Felicidades, hermanita. God bless y'all.
Okay, so we want to welcome everyone to our Sabbath service this morning. So we're going to get up and greet each other, sing our welcome song. Okay, going to do the tithes and offering now. Just have a short reading. It says, putting God first can be difficult. What can we learn from Abram that will help us put God first in our lives today? Abram was 80 years old when he left his rich and prosperous home to travel into the desert. God had called him, and Abram put God first. But a few years later, Abram began to lie to save his own life. Why did Abram become so fearful that he stopped putting God first? Time happened. Some of us become disappointed with God because our lives didn't turn out as we expected. However, if we follow Abram's example, we'll see that he had the courage to challenge God and demand his promises to be fulfilled. After all, Abram was promised a land and descendants. In Genesis 15, we can see Abram challenges God directly. He says, Lord God, what will you give me, seeing I go childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus? sometimes we need to also have some serious conversations with God too. Do not continue in silence if you have a few things to say to your Heavenly Father. Are you disappointed? Tell him. Do you feel alone when he promised to be with you? Challenge him as Abram did. God invited Abram to leave his tent and come outside. It is almost as if God is taking Abram from his limited reality and bringing him to God's reality. God says to Abram, your tent ceiling isn't large enough to accommodate what I can do for you. God reminds Abram that God is God and Abram is not. It is precisely because Abram put God first that his name was changed to Abraham, and his desire to be faithful led to the first biblical reference of tithing. So Abram put God first. His example compels us to do the same. So as the deacons collect the tithe and offering, we are challenged to put God first. So may the deacons come and receive. Pray. Father, we thank you for this Sabbath day of rest. We thank you that we have the opportunity to come into your presence, to worship you, to honor you, and to give you all glory and praise. We thank you for the offering that each and every member was able to give. We pray that you would bless this offering and may it be used to glorify your name wherever it goes. Thank you so much, Father, for loving us. Thank you for providing for our needs. Thank you for taking good care of us. We love you too. These and all other mercies we ask in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen and amen.
Our scripture reading this morning is in Matthew 27:5. La lectura bíblica esta mañana se encuentra en Mateo 27:5. Whether you have your Bible, physical copy, or whether you have your cell phone, take it out and let's look for those two scriptures, right? The good Lord is just happy, very happy for our need of him and our desire to connect with him. Así que nuevamente, les digo que la lectura bíblica se encuentra en Mateo 27:5, Matthew 27:5. And this is, I'll do it in English first. So Judas threw the money into the temple and left. Then he went away and hanged himself. Y arrojando las piezas de plata en el templo, salió y fue y se ahorcó.
It is now time for our Garden of Prayer. And for our Garden of Prayer today, we're going to do something a little bit different. I'm going to pray, but before I do that, we just want you to gather with the people that are sitting next to you and just pray for them. Just get in a circle or sit next to each other and just ask the people, the person, you know, how can I pray for you today? And especially if people are sitting alone, make sure you connect with them. But I'll give us a few minutes to get a few seconds to get together. We're going to sing our prayer song, Open Your Eyes, and then you could start praying. For each other. Father, hearing all these petitions, all these requests, Lord. Father, you know each and every one of us that are present here today, Lord. You know the worries of our mind, the troubles of our hearts, Lord. Lord, you see the condition of the world that we're living in and the overwhelming emotions that we suffer from, Lord. But Father, as the song says, we have this hope, Lord. Father, our hope is not in our beauty, not in our wealth, not in our stuff, Lord, but our hope is in you. As David says in Psalms 42, soul that's cast down, hope thou in God. Father, our hope is in you. And on this day, Lord, this Sabbath, Lord, we seek you, Father, our hope, our precious Creator, our Redeemer. Father, bless the families here today. Bless everyone, Father. No matter what they're going through, we just invite your presence, Lord, to be with them, to encourage them, and to know, Lord, that you've promised, Lord, even though we walk through the valleys of the shadow of death, you've promised, Lord, that even there you will be with us. In the good times and the bad times, you always are with us. May our hearts trust in you, Lord, with our burdens, our financial difficulties, the concerns we have for our children, Lord, our health situations, Lord, our class projects that need to be done, and all the other things that we worry about. Today, Lord, we put our trust and our hope in you. Bless us this day, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Have a wonderful song selection by Sister Jennifer as she comes up. Don't know what the song is, but I know it's going to be awesome.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. Happy Sabbath, little one. Way back on Calvary.
Oh, I have to thank you, Lord. I just wanna thank you, Lord. Oh, thanking you, 'cause you're wonderful, glorious, holy and righteous, victorious, conqueror, triumphant and mighty, healer, deliverer, shield and defense. You're my strong tower and my best friend, omnipotent, omnipresent, soon coming King. You're Alpha, Omega, Lord of everything. Lord, you're so holy, you're so holy. Holy is your name. You're so holy, Lord. Healer, deliverer, shield and defense. Nothing but a strong tower and my best friend. Omnipotent, omnipresent, soon coming King. You're Alpha, Omega, Lord of everything, Lord. You're so holy, you're so holy. Holy is your name. You're so holy. You're so holy, the angels cry, holy, holy is your name. The angels cry, holy, holy, holy is your name.
I can't sing like that. I can enjoy it, yes. Happy Sabbath again. Where is my, oh, yes. Oh, you're gonna need your light. Your light, your little light, yeah. So everyone should have a little light. Everyone has a light? You don't need it right now, but you will need a little light. All right, so make sure you have a light. Right. So again, we're going to talk about something that's very serious. I know it can be triggering for people. We are going to talk about suicide. Just wanted you to be mindful of that.
Buenos días, vamos a estar hablando de algo muy sensible que quizás pueda afectar a alguien. Vamos a estar hablando del suicidio, nada más para avisarles, ¿no?
But as a church, it is something that we need to talk about. It's something real that good Christians struggle with.
Pero como iglesia es algo de lo que necesitamos hablar porque es algo con lo que aún buenos cristianos luchan.
So let us pray and get into the topic for today.
Oremos.
Lord, thank you again for this opportunity to worship you, Lord.
Señor, gracias nuevamente por la oportunidad de alabarlo.
Father, may the words that we hear today,
Señor, que las palabras que escuchemos hoy,
sink in our heart, Lord, and give us hope.
Puedan entrar a nuestro corazón y darnos esperanza.
If not for ourselves, but for someone who needs it.
Si no para nosotros, para alguien que la necesita escuchar.
Lord, most of all, may we learn to trust in you, even in dark times.
Señor, sobre todo que podamos aprender a confiar en usted, sobre todo en esos momentos oscuros.
Amen.
Amen.
So you're going to see this number on here,
through every other slider. So 988 is the national hotline for suicide. So they receive calls, text messages, 24/7. So that information is on there. If you feel like there's a need, even if you need to step out, please utilize that, or you can share it with others.
Van a estar viendo en las diapositivas ese número, que es un número al que pueden hablar si necesitan ayuda, si están contemplando, teniendo pensamientos de suicidio, lo van a estar viendo desplegado ahí en la pantalla.
So last week we talked about Job. For those of you who are here, if you weren't, we do have that somewhat showing on our page. They didn't record nice and well. It's still there. You can hear me.
La semana pasada, para los que no estuvieron con nosotros, platicamos, tuvimos un tema sobre Job, el personaje en la Biblia.
And so,
si lo necesitan buscar, está en nuestra página, aunque no se grabó muy bien, dice.
And so one of the things we talked about is that as Christians, we highlight the initial reaction Job had to trauma.
Y una de las cosas que platicamos es que como cristianos tendemos a resaltar la primera reacción que tuvo Job con el trauma.
And so as we see here in Job chapter 1, verses 20 through 22, you know, Job says, you know, naked I came out, you know, and naked I'll depart. The Lord gives, the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Right?
Y lo vemos desplegado ahí en la pantalla. Es desnudo salí del vientre de mi madre, desnudo tornaré allí. Jehová dio, Jehová quitó, sea bendito el nombre de Jehová.
But we overlook
that's it? Usually go long.
No, we're not. Oh, there we go. We overlook Job's despair, Job's dark thoughts, Job wrestling with his mental health.
Pero muchas veces pasamos por alto la oscuridad que atravesó Job, sus pensamientos oscuros, su desesperación.
That same Job tells us in Job 14:1 that it's not long after we're born that we get into trouble, that we have trials and tribulations in this world.
Ese mismo Job, en el capítulo 14, versículo 1 del libro de Job, nos dice que no es mucho después que un ser humano, después de nacer de mujer, enfrenta problemas en esta vida.
Then we see Job wrestling with these thoughts.
Después vemos a Job luchando con estos pensamientos.
He goes into really dark places. Job 3:11, why did I not perish at birth?
Se va a unos lugares muy oscuros. Job 3:11, ¿por qué no nací muerto?
And we see that in Job 6, he's grappling again with this. Why didn't God take my life? Job is grappling with being alive.
Y vemos de nuevo ese pensamiento en Job capítulo 6, donde dice, ¿por qué el Señor no me quita la vida?
Job wishes for death.
Job pide la muerte, desea la muerte.
Job 3:21.
Job 3, versículo 21.
He's talking about God and why does God allow people to live life that's bitter and full of sorrows, even people who are waiting for death.
En el versículo 21 dice que por qué Dios le permite la vida a las personas que están sufriendo, aún a las personas que están esperando la muerte, deseando la muerte.
And I highlighted in verse 21, look at how he talks about death. Those who search for death more than treasures.
Y lo resalté, dice, en el versículo 21 dice, esos que buscan la muerte más que a un tesoro.
Verse 22, who rejoice exceedingly when they are glad, and they are glad when they find the grave.
Aquellos que se regocijan, dice, de sobremanera cuando encuentran la tumba.
This is the same Job that the Bible tells us in the beginning of the story that he was perfect.
Este es el mismo Job que al principio del relato la Biblia nos dice que era perfecto.
You couldn't find a better Christian than Job. That's how the Bible describes him.
No podías encontrar un mejor cristiano que Job, así es como lo describe la Biblia.
You couldn't find someone that had more faith in God than Job.
No podías encontrar a alguien que tuviera más fe en Dios que Job.
I don't care how righteous you think you are, how righteous I think I am, Job was the most righteous man. Read the story.
No importa cuán justo te creas tú o cuán justo me creo yo, Job era la persona más justa. Lee la historia.
That same righteous, perfect, godly man is glorifying death as a solution to his problem.
Ese mismo hombre justo, perfecto, está glorificando la muerte.
Job experienced a great loss, as we all know.
Job experimentó una gran pérdida.
He was in pain, he was suffering.
Estaba en dolor, estaba sufriendo.
In his situation, he does not see a way out.
En la situación en la que está Job, no ve una salida.
His only conclusion was to seek relief in death.
Su única solución, lo veía él, es encontrar alivio en la muerte.
And so Job was having what we refer to as suicidal thoughts or suicidal ideations.
Job lo que estaba atravesando era pensamientos suicidas. Y I forgot the last phrase.
Suicidal ideations.
Ideas de suicidio. Perdón.
That works.
Se me trabó.
It's this place that people find themselves where they don't want to die, but they don't know how to live.
Es un lugar donde se encuentra la persona donde no quieren morir, pero no saben vivir.
And so suicide becomes an end to a means, an end to suffering, an end to pain.
Y entonces el suicidio se convierte en un fin al dolor y al sufrimiento.
And it's something that for generations after generations all over the world that we struggle with. Even in Bible times you find 6 instances of suicide.
Y esto es algo con lo que ha luchado la humanidad en toda la historia, y en la Biblia encontramos 6 casos de suicidio.
And you see all of them there. We're not going to go into all the stories, but, you know, Abimelech. Interestingly enough, Abimelech was killed by, he didn't want to be known to be killed by a woman, so he killed himself so that they wouldn't say he was killed by a woman.
Abimelech, interesantemente, no quería que dijeran que una mujer lo mató, así que se terminó de matar a él.
But you have all these individuals, especially in the Old Testament, that died by suicide.
Pero tenemos todos esos individuos, especialmente en el Antiguo Testamento, que murieron por suicidio.
And we particularly use the term died by suicide or completed a suicide instead of using the word commit a suicide. We use the word die by suicide or complete a suicide instead of saying committed or commit a suicide.
Nosotros decimos que murió por suicidio o completó un suicidio en vez de cometió un suicidio.
To remove that stigma because you commit a crime.
Para remover ese estigma de que cometiste un crimen.
So we don't want to add stigma to someone and say they commit a suicide.
Así que no le queremos agregar más estigma a alguien diciendo que cometió un suicidio.
So the last one you saw in the Bible is our scripture reading, Judas.
Así que el último el personaje que vimos ahí en los seis que estaban es Judas.
And you remember the story of Judas, and quite frankly, a lot of us don't have any love for Judas.
Y cuando recordamos la historia de Judas, francamente, no muchos de nosotros le tenemos amor a Judas.
But need I remind you that there were two people who betrayed Jesus.
Pero déjame recordarte que hubo dos personas que traicionaron a Jesús.
Judas and who?
Judas y quién más?
Peter.
Pedro.
Not only did Peter say he didn't know Jesus.
No solamente dijo, negó Pedro conocer a Jesús.
This is the same Peter who said, Jesus, I got your back. I'll die for you, Jesus.
Este es el mismo Pedro que dijo que él moriría por Jesús.
And when they came to arrest Judas, Jesus, what did Peter do?
Y cuando vinieron a arrestar a Jesús, ¿qué hizo Pedro?
He pulled out his switchblade.
Sacó su
chopped
navaja,
up a guy's ear.
Y le cortó la oreja a alguien.
To protect, to defend Jesus.
Para proteger, para defender a Jesús.
That same individual.
Ese mismo individuo.
Three times said, I don't know him.
Tres veces dijo, no lo conozco.
In fact, the third time there was emphasis, he cussed.
Es más, en la tercera vez que lo negó, lo hizo enfáticamente y esto son malas palabras.
And I'm not going to imitate that. You fill in the blanks.
Y no hay que imitar eso, ahí pueden llenar el espacio.
But these two individuals went very different routes.
Pero estos dos individuos se fueron por rutas muy distintas.
We have Peter, who went away in disgrace and was restored by Jesus later. But look at what happened to Judas.
Tenemos a Pedro que se fue en desgracia, pero después lo restauró Jesús. Pero veamos qué le sucedió a Judas.
Confronted with his guilt and what he did,
enfrentado con su culpa de lo que él hizo,
he goes to get it resolved. He goes to the priest.
Trata de arreglarlo, va con los sacerdotes.
And isn't this interesting? He goes to the place where he should have gotten help, but he did not get help.
Y esto es interesante, se fue al lugar donde debió haber encontrado ayuda, pero no encontró ayuda.
So look at what it says in verse 4. I have sinned. I have betrayed innocent blood.
Noten lo que dice el versículo 4. Yo he pecado, he entregado sangre inocente.
And the response he got from the people who were supposed to help him was basically, I don't care, we don't care, deal with it yourself.
Y la respuesta de las personas que le debieron haber ayudado fue, a nosotros no nos importa, esa es tu responsabilidad.
And so he did.
Así que él lo solucionó.
He took his own life.
Tomó su propia vida.
Again, suicide is a permanent solution to a temporary problem.
De nuevo, el suicidio es un arreglo permanente para un problema que es temporal.
That wasn't the only option for Judas, because Peter also betrayed Jesus, but that was the option he chose.
Esa no era la única opción para Judas, porque Pedro también traicionó a Jesús, pero esta fue la opción que él escogió.
Peter also betrayed innocent blood.
Pedro también había traicionado sangre inocente.
In a different way.
De otra manera, pero
nonetheless he did.
Pero igual traicionó.
A permanent solution, a permanent measure for something that is temporary.
El suicidio es una solución permanente para algo que es temporal.
Would Jesus have forgiven Judas?
¿Ustedes creen que Jesús hubiera perdonado a Judas?
He would have. He forgave the people who were crucifying him as they were crucifying him. So I have no doubt that he would not have forgotten. He would have forgiven Judas.
Él perdonó aún hasta la gente que lo estaba crucificando, así que no tengo ninguna duda que hubiera perdonado a Judas.
But Judas never had that opportunity. He never gave himself that opportunity.
Pero Judas no se dio esa oportunidad.
Unfortunately, that's the choice some people make. Around the world, every 40 seconds, someone dies by
Tristemente,
suicide.
Esa es la opción que mucha gente escoge. Alrededor del mundo, cada 40 segundos, alguien muere por suicidio.
Think of how long you've been up this morning.
Piensa en qué tanto rato has estado despierto esta mañana.
And how many people have died by suicide just from the moment you've got up to the moment you're sitting here now.
Piensa cuánta gente se ha quitado la vida desde el momento que te levantaste hasta este momento.
In the United States, every 11 minutes.
En Estados Unidos, cada 11 minutos.
Think about that. From the moment you've been up till now, in the U.S., divided by 11 minutes, and that's the amount of people who died by suicide.
Piensa en esto, en Estados Unidos cada 11 minutos muere una persona. Divide el tiempo que has estado despierto por esos 11 minutos.
And we've seen the stories, and it happens to anyone.
Hemos visto las historias y le puede suceder a cualquiera.
Different genders, different races, different economic situations.
Diferentes géneros, diferentes sexos, diferentes razas, diferentes situaciones económicas.
And you wonder why there are children on there.
Y nos preguntamos por qué hay niños allí.
Guess how young the youngest child on there is who died by suicide.
Adivina cuántos años tiene el niño más pequeño que está ahí en la pantalla que murió por suicidio.
What do you think? 8 is close, but it's lower. 7 years old.
7 años. 7 años tiene el niño más pequeño que está en la pantalla.
Age, it doesn't matter. Success level,
no
doesn't
importa
matter.
La edad, no importa cuánto éxito hayas tenido.
The success that people have attained,
no importa el éxito que hayan tenido.
It is a choice that people make.
Es una decisión que gente toma.
To end the pain, to end the suffering, to end the misery.
Para terminar con el dolor, la miseria y el sufrimiento.
Even when people don't die by suicide, there are people who attempt and they are not successful.
Y aunque la gente no se muera por suicidio, hay gente que hace el intento y no son exitosos.
And sometimes that makes things even more horrible for them.
Y a veces eso hacen las cosas más horribles para ellos.
Because they develop some very debilitating conditions.
Porque terminan con una condición muy debilitada después.
And there's what we call self-harm, where people are not really wanting to end their lives, but because of certain behaviors of self-harm, like cutting specifically, they end up dying accidentally.
Y a veces hay gente que se quiere hacer daño, se quieren lastimar, como hay gente que se corta, pero a veces en esos en esas situaciones donde están cortando accidentalmente terminan quitándose la vida.
So it's something that we need to talk about.
Así que es un tema que tenemos que abordar.
And so I'm going to show a video that, you know, talks about suicide. It's in Spanish, but no worries, the message I'm sharing covers all of that, so if you don't understand Spanish, you'll still get everything.
Van a compartir un video que está en español, y él dice que no se preocupen los que hablan inglés, les va el tema que va a cubrir todo lo que van a ver.
Los comportamientos suicidas y autolesivos son importantes problemas sociales y de salud en todo el mundo, particularmente entre los jóvenes, donde los índices de autolesión superan los de los adultos. Para muchas personas, lastimarse o provocarse daño físico se puede convertir en una solución para manejar las emociones intensas cuando éstas se vuelven abrumadoras, o para sentir algo y llenar ese vacío interno. Para otras, las conductas de autolesiones pueden ser intencionales con el objetivo de quitarse la vida. No todos los que se involucran en estos comportamientos morirán por suicidio. Sin embargo, las conductas de autolesivas pueden escalar y conducir al suicidio. Todos estos comportamientos comparten factores de riesgo similares, tales como presencia de depresión o ansiedad, antecedentes o historia personal de trauma, abuso físico o sexual, sentimientos de inutilidad, problemas financieros o abuso de sustancias. Comprender qué podría causar que un ser querido se involucre en conductas suicidas y autolesivas puede ser difícil, pero existen algunas señales de alerta y signos comunes como hablar o escribir con frecuencia sobre la muerte, no participar en interacciones sociales, aislarse o evitar el contacto social, aumento del consumo de alcohol y uso indebido de drogas. La intervención y prevención del suicidio y la autolesión debe incluir un enfoque clínico y social. Si alguien que usted conoce le indica que considera el suicidio o muestra signos de autolesión, escúchelo y tómelo con seriedad. Hágale saber que usted está allí y no está solo o sola. Además, anímelo a que busque la ayuda de un profesional de atención médica. La línea 988 de suicidio y crisis también ofrece apoyo confidencial para personas que sufren de angustia relacionada con problemas de salud mental. Para más información sobre el suicidio y la autolesión, así como las opciones de prevención, visite www.lasaludmental.org.
So, just some more statistics about suicide, and I'll just highlight certain ones because there's a lot. So I'm going to highlight some different statistics about suicide.
Vamos a resaltar unas estadísticas tocante al suicidio.
So one of the populations that has the highest suicide rates are people who are elderly or older.
Una de las áreas donde se ve más altos niveles de suicidio es entre las personas que de más edad, de 75 años en adelante.
And then we have males. Males tend to have a higher rate of suicide than females.
Y los hombres también, hay más alto incidencia de suicidio entre los hombres que las mujeres.
What we showed earlier from the Bible scriptures, they were all men.
Y la lista que dimos de casos de suicidio en la Biblia, todos eran hombres.
So look at this in number three. Although males make up about 50% of the population, they make up 80% of suicides.
Y aunque los hombres representan el 50% de la población, componen el 80% de los casos de suicidio.
And then for our young people, it's even worse.
Y para nuestros jóvenes es peor.
Look at number four.
Vean el número cuatro.
How many people in here are either or between 10 and 14? Raise your hand. 10 and 14.
¿Quiénes de aquí tienen, están entre la edad de 10 a 14 años?
How many of you know kids between 10 and 14? Suicide is the second leading cause. The second leading cause for people that age group.
Entre niños de 10 a 14 años, el suicidio es la segunda causa de muerte.
And as they go through life, as they matriculate, it continues. You see 13% of high school girls, attempted suicide.
Y el 13% de las niñas de la preparatoria han intentado suicidarse.
And it affects every community. 2019, suicide was the second leading cause of death of Hispanics ages 15 to 34.
Y afecta a diferentes comunidades. En el 2019, entre la comunidad de hispanos, el suicidio fue la segunda causa en los hispanos de edad de 15 a 34 años.
In the black community, it's even worse.
En la comunidad afroamericana es peor.
And so the group with the highest increase in suicide attempts are black adolescents. It went up by 73%.
Y el grupo que más incrementó en suicidios fue en jóvenes de raza negra. Hubo un incremento del 73%.
So, I used to hear people say, oh, you know, that's a white people problem.
He escuchado a mucha gente decir que es un problema de gente blanca.
No, it's not. It affects every community.
Y no lo es. Afecta a todas las comunidades.
Especially our children.
Especialmente a nuestros niños.
What about the good old state of Texas?
¿Qué tal el estado de Texas?
11th cause, leading cause of death in the state of Texas.
El suicidio es la causa número 11 en el estado de Texas.
And you see that it's the second leading cause of death of individuals 10 through 24. that should scare us. Talking about 10 years old, the second leading cause of death.
Y la segunda causa de muerte entre, y esto es en Texas, de niños de 10, de entre el grupo de 10 a 24 años.
So all the way in through adolescence, young adulthood, second leading cause of death, till they're 34.
De hecho, es hasta los 34 años. Es la segunda causa de muerte en el estado de Texas, desde los 10 a 34 años.
And you see it being present throughout all stages of life.
Y lo ves presente en todas las etapas de la vida.
So, it's así. Something that's real, that impacts all of us.
Así que es algo real que nos impacta a todos.
The highest incidence, highest rates of suicide in Texas is Lubbock. I don't know if you've all been there, don't know where that is.
El lugar que tiene más incidentes de suicidio es Lubbock. Lubbock, Texas.
And look at the age ranges, 6 through 17.
Y el rango de edad, fíjense, noten, es de los 6 años a los 17.
Again, that should scare us.
Eso nos debería asustar.
We have 6-year-olds, 7-year-olds, 8-year-olds taking their own lives.
Cuando ves que niños de 6, 7, 8 años están quitando la vida.
And then that's followed by San Antonio and Dallas.
Y a Lubbock lo sigue San Antonio y luego Dallas.
So it's something that's real.
Así que es algo que es real.
So let's talk about some myths that there are about suicide.
Vamos a platicar tocante unos mitos relacionados con el suicidio.
One of the big myths is that you shouldn't talk about it.
Uno de los mitos más grandes es que no debes de hablar del suicidio.
Because talking about it will all of a sudden increase someone's chances of doing it.
Porque si hablamos del suicidio, entonces van a incrementar la posibilidad de que alguien vaya a actuar.
The reality is, talking about it reduces the stigma, allows people to share that they're having these thoughts, and it helps us to help them deal with it in a healthy way.
La realidad es que al hablar sobre el suicidio, reduce el estigma relacionado al suicidio, entonces las personas se pueden abrir más a platicar si están teniendo problemas o pensando en suicidarse.
So myth number two, people who talk about suicide, they're just trying to get some attention.
El segundo mito es que la gente que habla del suicidio solamente quieren atención.
The reality is whenever someone talks about it, we need to take it seriously.
La realidad es que cuando alguien habla del suicidio, tenemos que tomarlo en serio.
Because even if someone is seeking attention, they might do it and have a lethal end to get that attention.
Porque aunque sea cierto que alguien está buscando atención, puede que intenten suicidarse y ganen la atención de esa manera.
Myth number three is that suicide cannot be prevented.
Mito número tres es que el suicidio no se puede prevenir.
Yes, it can.
Sí se puede prevenir.
I've worked with many individuals who've grappled with it, who are still alive today.
He trabajado con muchos individuos que han luchado con eso y todavía están vivos hoy.
Myth number four, people who take their own lives are selfish, coward and weak.
Mito número cuatro, la gente que se quita su propia vida son egoístas, cobardes y débiles.
That's not true. In fact, one of the reasons people give you that they want to end it all is that they could stop being a burden to their family.
Y eso no es cierto. Una de las razones que muchas veces dan individuos que se han quitado las vidas es que quieren dejar de ser una carga para sus familias.
So in their minds, they're being selfless.
Así que en sus mentes, ellos no están siendo egoístas.
Far from being a coward, they see themselves as brave for doing something so challenging to do.
Más allá de considerarse cobarde, se ven como alguien muy valiente porque están haciendo algo que cuesta bastante esfuerzo hacer.
Myth number five is that a person who talks about it rarely follows through.
Mito número cinco, una persona que habla del suicidio raramente lo hace, lo lleva a cabo.
Take it seriously. Take them seriously.
Tómalo en serio. Dales importancia a ellos.
Myth number six, it always occurs. Suicide always occurs without any warning signs.
Mito número seis es que el suicidio ocurre sin dar ningún aviso.
Well, in some cases that might be true. A lot of times it's not, and a lot of times we don't ask the right questions.
En ciertos casos puede que sí sea verdad, pero muchas veces es que no estamos poniendo atención y no hacemos las preguntas correctas.
They're usually warning signs, and I'll share what some of those are a little bit later.
Normalmente hay avisos, y voy a compartir con ustedes más adelante cuáles son unos de ellos.
Myth number seven, once someone becomes suicidal, they will always be suicidal.
Mito número siete, una vez que alguien se tenga pensamientos o tendencias suicidas, siempre se van a quedar así.
That's not true. There are a lot of people who, especially when they're younger, have those thoughts, but learn different coping skills, and they move on with their lives.
Y eso no es cierto. Hay mucha gente que cuando están en la adolescencia, en sus años jóvenes, tienen estos tipos de pensamientos, pero aprenden a acoplarse a diferentes situaciones y luego ya crecen, ya no tienen ese problema.
And myth number eight, people who attempt suicide and survive will never ever do it again.
Mito número ocho, las personas que intentan suicidio y fallan, ya jamás lo van a volver a intentar.
That is not true. That person has a likelihood, a higher chance that they will do that again if something else happens in their life later on.
Eso no es cierto. De hecho, van a tener un riesgo más alto de intentarlo de nuevo si enfrentan otra situación difícil en su vida.
Myth number nine. Christians are immune from suicide.
Mito número nueve, los cristianos son inmunes al suicidio.
Or myth number 10, if you truly believed in God, if you had the faith of the apostles and the faith of Jesus Christ, then you would never ever have suicidal thoughts.
Mito número 10, si verdaderamente creyeras en Dios, tuvieras la fe de los apóstoles, jamás considerarías o tendrías pensamientos de suicidio.
We already talked about Job. None of us can top Job.
Ya hablamos de Job. Ninguno de nosotros puede superar a Job.
God has never said about you that you're perfect.
Dios nunca ha dicho de ti que eres perfecto.
Or me, perfecta, for that matter.
O de él.
He said that about Job.
Y lo dijo de Job.
David, we haven't even talked about David. You read the Psalms, you read the story of David. David had those thoughts.
David, no hemos platicado de David, pero si tú lees los Salmos, David también tuvo pensamientos así.
He struggled with his mental health greatly.
Tuvo también problemas de salud mental.
And what does God say about him? He's a man after my own what?
¿Y qué dice Dios de él? Es un hombre conforme a mi corazón.
So you can be a Christian, you can be a follower of Jesus Christ. You
así
could have a wonderful relationship with him and still struggle with suicidal ideation.
Así que puedes ser un cristiano y tener una relación maravillosa con Dios y todavía estar luchando, bregando con el suicidio.
So, common signs of suicidal thoughts. What does it look like?
Señas de que alguien está teniendo, señales que alguien está teniendo pensamientos suicidas.
So this is what you're looking for.
Eso es lo que debes de estar, debes de estar poniendo atención a ver si ves esto.
A person is talking about death a lot.
Una persona está hablando mucho tocante a la muerte.
Remember how earlier we talked about Job and those different things, he was glorifying death?
Acuérdense, hace ratito estábamos hablando de Job, cómo estaba glorificando la muerte.
Same thing. Mood swings.
Cambios en el de humor. Muy drásticos.
Sometimes people make plans. They update their will. They start giving stuff away, saying goodbye.
Hay gente que hace planes, empiezan a actualizar su testamento, empiezan a despedirse.
They're gathering the instruments that they're going to use, a weapon or pills.
Empiezan a buscar con qué se van a quitar la vida, pastillas, una pistola, un arma.
They also start withdrawing. They start pulling themselves away from activities, family functions, hanging out with you, these different things.
También se comienzan a aislar, se empiezan a retirar de funciones sociales, actividades con la familia, cosas así.
That heavy isolation, just always wanting to be by themselves.
Se empiezan a aislar mucho y siempre quieren estar solos.
Calling you up and essentially having a conversation that sounds like a goodbye.
Te llaman y tienen una conversación contigo que parece que se está despidiendo la persona.
So these are some of the signs that you want to look for and look at in individuals who are grappling with suicidal thoughts.
Estas son señales de que a veces dan individuos que están pensando en suicidarse.
So how do you respond?
Así que ¿cómo respondes?
If you're having those thoughts.
Si tú estás teniendo esos pensamientos.
In our lesson on depression, we talked about not owning certain thoughts.
En nuestra plática sobre la depresión, hablamos de que no aceptes ciertos pensamientos, no son tuyos.
Yeah, they're not your thoughts, they're intrusion, they're thieves that broke in.
Son pensamientos intrusos, son ladrones que se están metiendo.
Very important, reach out to someone you trust.
Y es muy importante que tú contactes a alguien en quien confías.
Instead of doing something that's going to cause a lot of pain, give them an opportunity, give the people in your life who love you an opportunity to help you.
En vez de hacer algo que va a causar mucho dolor, dale la oportunidad a alguien en tu vida que le importas para que te ayuden.
And get it out, express your feelings. Hey, I'm having these thoughts, I don't know what to do about them.
Y expresa tus sentimientos, di, hey, estoy teniendo estos pensamientos y no sé qué hacer.
And not just one person, but create a network of support of people around you that you can go to, that you can talk to when you're having these feelings.
Y no solamente una persona, sino trata de hacer una red de apoyo. Varias personas para platicar de lo que está pasando contigo.
And if you're grappling again, reduce your daily stress. And I want to emphasize taking time off.
Y si estás bregando con pensamientos, esas cosas difíciles del suicidio, trata de reducir tus niveles de estrés. Quiero enfatizar a que te tomes un día personal.
One of the most powerful things to me that the Adventist Church has is the Sabbath.
Una de las cosas más poderosas que tiene la Iglesia Adventista, de mi punto de vista, es el sábado.
But we have a very wrong way of emphasizing it.
Pero tenemos una manera muy equivocada de enfatizarlo.
It's not about the specific day versus Sunday.
No es específicamente el contraste del sábado con el domingo.
And that is important, that is a truth.
Y eso es importante, y sí es una verdad.
But as Brother Oscar preached the other day, several weeks ago, and if you weren't here, please, we have it recorded. Go listen to it.
Pero como el hermano Oscar predicó el otro día, y si no estuvieron, búsquenlo, ahí lo tenemos grabado.
God created this space and time for us. God doesn't need to rest.
Dios creó este espacio en el tiempo para nosotros. Dios no necesita descansar.
The Sabbath was made for us.
El sábado fue hecho para nosotros.
For our emotional, spiritual, and mental well-being.
Para nuestro bien espiritual, físico y mental.
We live in a society, a culture that's go, 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 go. That's how you become successful.
Vivimos en una sociedad que siempre anda deprisa y que te enseña que así se obtiene el éxito.
If I was an Adventist, I would work 24/7.
Si yo no fuera adventista, trabajara las 24 horas del día, los 7 días a la semana.
That's how I was raised.
Así me criaron.
It's very important for our mental health to take time off.
Es muy importante para nuestra salud mental tomar un día de descanso.
We are the only developed country in the world that every year thousands of hours of vacation go unused.
Somos el único país desarrollado en el mundo donde cada año miles de horas de vacaciones no se usan, no se toman.
People work day in, day out without taking a break. That's how we're trained.
La gente trabaja día tras día sin tomar descanso y así estamos entrenados.
Even if you're not having a bad week, take a day off.
Aunque no tengas una semana pesada, tómate un día libre.
I do it all the time. Those of you who know me know what I do with it.
Yo lo hago todo el tiempo y aquellos que me conocen ya saben lo que hago.
I go fishing.
Me voy de pesca.
Here's another idea.
Y aquí va otra idea.
What about giving our kids a day off?
¿Qué tal de darle a nuestros hijos un día libre?
What about a mental health day for our children?
¿Qué tal de un día de salud mental para nuestros hijos?
I showed you the statistics for a reason.
Les enseñé las estadísticas por una razón.
With all the complexities of being a young person in today's society, why don't we allow our children to have mental health days?
Con todas las complicaciones de ser un adolescente en estos días, en estos tiempos, ¿por qué no le damos a nuestros hijos un día de libre para su salud mental?
Now this sounds crazy, right? Not sending your kid to school?
Esto suena loco, ¿verdad? No mandar a tus hijos a la escuela.
Well, what if they have all the hours of school, but you lose them anyway?
Pero ¿qué tal si tienen todas esas horas de escuela y los pierdes de todos modos?
Take time off.
Tómense tiempo libre.
We talked about spiritual discipline, right? Prayer, meditation, reflecting, ministry.
Hablamos de las disciplinas espirituales, ¿verdad? De la oración, la meditación, la reflexión, el ministerio.
Reject isolation.
Rechaza el aislamiento.
We were made to connect.
Fuimos hechos para conectarnos.
God is relational. That's how he revealed himself to us. Father, Son, Holy Spirit.
Dios es relacional, así se nos ha revelado, Padre, Hijo, Espíritu Santo.
We were created in his image. We were created to be in relationships.
Fuimos creados a su imagen, fuimos creados para estar en relaciones.
And when we're disconnected, that affects us.
Y cuando estamos desconectados, eso nos afecta.
Seek and maintain healthy, positive relationships with people.
Busca y mantiene relaciones sanas con gente.
We also talk about getting out of your head with the negative thinking, the intrusive thoughts.
También hablamos de, man, how do I translate get out of your head?
Stop thinking negative.
hablamos también de dejar de estar atrapado en tus pensamientos.
Practice gratitude.
Practica la gratitud, agradecimiento.
Give thanks, be thankful. There are a lot of things you don't have.
Da gracias, sé agradecido en muchas cosas que no tienes.
But there are a lot of things you have that other people would love to have.
Pero hay muchas que sí tienes que a otra gente le encantaría tener.
Like the ability to get up.
Como la habilidad de levantarse.
And walk without pain.
Y caminar sin dolor.
A lot of people have difficulty with that.
Hay mucha gente que batalla con eso.
You're here, I'm here.
Tú estás aquí, yo estoy aquí.
Be thankful for the things that you have.
Sea agradecido por las cosas que tienes.
How do you help someone who's struggling? If someone comes to you and said, hey, Dr. Johnson says, if you're having these thoughts, to reach out. They reached out, right? What do you do?
¿Cómo tratas con alguien que está teniendo esos pensamientos? ¿Qué tal si alguien te contacta, Dr. Johnson me dijo que si veo a alguien así, que hable, que aquí estoy para ayudarte. Pero bueno, que ahí te contactaron y ahora, ¿cómo les ayudas?
So, I'm going to show another video. It's also in Spanish. No worries. I'm going to say everything in English. So, those of you who don't understand.
Vamos a mostrar otro video. Va a estar en español. Y no se preocupen los que hablan inglés. Todo lo vamos a cubrir ahorita en la plática.
Hablar de suicidio es difícil.
Y escuchar a alguien hablar del suicidio también es difícil.
Pero es muy importante que nos enfrentemos a esa dificultad.
Porque hacerlo puede salvar vidas.
Escuchar es de hecho una de las mejores maneras que existen para ayudar. Porque las personas que se suicidan
muchas veces comunican su intención previamente. Por eso hay señales de alerta a las que les puedes prestar atención.
Aislamiento y retraimiento.
Desinterés o desmotivación.
Episodios de llanto inconsolable.
Desesperanzas o ideas negativas persistentes.
Sentimiento de tristeza constante.
Sentimiento de soledad, debilidad. Fracaso.
Dificultades para dormir y comer.
Estas situaciones pueden existir independientemente de que la persona tenga un padecimiento mental.
Otra cosa que hay que tener en cuenta es que aunque la persona dé señales de estar mejor o sobreviva a un intento de suicidio,
esto no necesariamente quiere decir que esté fuera de peligro.
Este es uno de los momentos más complejos porque la persona se encuentra frágil y sigue estando en situación de riesgo.
Es clave seguir acompañando en esta instancia.
Entonces, si notas que alguna persona de tu entorno podría tener la intención de suicidarse,
lo mejor que puedes hacer es escucharla,
mostrar interés,
darle apoyo
y acompañarla al centro de salud más cercano para que pueda recibir la atención adecuada.
Si no quiere recibir asistencia,
podés pedir orientación y asesoramiento en un centro de salud.
Prevenir el suicidio es cosa de todos
y todas.
So how do you help someone?
¿Cómo le ayudas a alguien?
Remember we talked about number one, we talked about this in Job's experience, right? Listen without reacting.
Número uno, ¿se acuerdan que hablamos de esto cuando platicamos de la experiencia de Job? Cuando los amigos llegaron y estuvieron calladitos una semana nada más ahí presentes, es escuchar. Número uno es escuchar.
You're thinking of what? That's crazy. You can't do that.
Quizás estás pensando, ¿qué? Eso es una locura, no se puede hacer eso.
What do you think is going to happen if you have that kind of reaction?
Oh, I was translating something totally different. Dice, no puedes decirles, ¿qué? Eso es una locura, no puedes hacer eso. ¿Qué crees tú que va a ser la reacción de otra persona cuando tú les contestas así?
Yeah, they're going to shut down.
Se van a cerrar.
They already feel ashamed.
Ya sienten vergüenza.
Especially if you're a man.
Especialmente si eres hombre.
Lost your job.
Perdiste tu empleo.
You're supposed to provide for your family.
Debes de proveer para tu familia.
You already feel less than and worthless.
Ya te sientes menos, te sientes que no vales.
And to have someone that you build up the courage to tell them, hey, I'm having these thoughts, and they respond that way, you're going to shut down.
Y cuando ya te armas de valor y vas y encuentras a alguien, les dices, hey, estoy teniendo estos pensamientos, y reaccionan de esa manera, te vas a cerrar.
Number two, very important. Don't beat around the bush with this subject.
Número dos, muy importante. Y no le saques, no te andes por las ramas con este tema.
Ask them, hey, are you thinking of taking your life? Are you thinking of hurting yourself?
Pregúntales directamente, hey, ¿estás pensando en quitarte la vida o hacerte daño?
That is very important. You want to ask that very straightforward.
Eso es muy importante. Tienes que hacerle muy directa esa pregunta.
Number three, you want to know if the person has a plan.
Número tres, quieres saber si esa persona tiene un plan.
Are they struggling with just thoughts, or they've been thinking about it for a while, they have a plan, and this is what they're going to do?
¿Están nada más luchando con pensamientos o ya lo han estado pensando por bastante rato y ya tienen un plan y eso es lo que van a hacer?
And that's why number two is important. You want to ask them straightforward and ask them about their plans. What were you thinking of doing? What is the plan that you have?
Entonces, por eso número dos es muy importante. Les tienes que preguntar directamente y tienes que seguirlo con la, y qué son los planes que tienes, qué estabas pensando hacer.
So it's either passive, which means they've been thinking about it, haven't really committed to a way, they don't have any pills or weapons, or it's imminent where, oh yeah, tomorrow or this afternoon, this is what I'm going to do.
Entonces tienes que llegar a la conclusión si es pasivo, que solamente lo han estado pensando, o si es inminente, donde la persona ya tiene planes, ya está a punto de actuar.
So if it's passive, just having the thoughts, you want to support them, you want to connect them with the help that they need and monitor that situation.
Si es pasivo, quieres darles apoyo y tratar de conectarlos con gente que los puedan ayudar.
If it's imminent and it's they have a plan, they have the means to do it, you want to do everything you can immediately to keep them safe.
Si es inminente, ya tienen los planes y los medios para llevar a cabo ese plan, tienes que hacer algo inmediato y conseguirles ayuda para que no se hagan daño.
So, for instance, if they have a weapon at home and you're with them, you want to call the house, you want to call someone who's at the house and say, hey, this is what's happening, we need you to secure that weapon.
Si, por ejemplo, la persona tiene un arma en su casa y la persona está contigo, debes de contactar a alguien en la casa y decir, hey, está sucediendo esto, necesito que guardes esa arma.
You want to get the pills.
Quieres esconder las píldoras.
So whatever it is that you need to do, and that might involve including other people, and that's okay.
Tienes que hacer todo lo que esté a tu alcance hacer y quizás eso quiere decir que tengas que involucrar a otra gente, a otras personas, y eso está bien.
This is the one secret that you shouldn't keep.
Este es el secreto que no debes de guardar.
I'm not talking about if they're passively thinking about it, they're having the thoughts, you know, you want to have that confidence with them and work with them, but if they're in immediate danger, they're about to do this, this is a secret you cannot keep.
No estoy hablando de cuando están en la etapa donde es pasivo, donde han tenido pensamientos, sino la etapa donde ya tienen un plan y están a punto de actuar, entonces no te lo debes de guardar.
Yes, they may be mad at you.
Sí, se pueden enojar contigo.
They'll get through it when they're alive and celebrating 10 years down the road.
Pero lo van a superar cuando estén vivos 10 años más adelante.
Don't let the fear of them being angry at you keep you from doing the right thing.
No dejes que el miedo de que esa persona se enoje contigo te haga que no hagas lo que es correcto.
I've had clients in my office who I know have an active plan, and you're not gonna leave right now, or we're gonna call the ambulance to take you. We're gonna call your mom, your husband, your wife, whoever, because I'm not letting you leave this office right now.
He tenido pacientes en mi consultorio que me he dado cuenta que tienen ya un plan ya formado y están a punto de actuar y no los he dejado que se vayan de mi oficina, ya sea que llame una ambulancia que lo recoja, su mamá o algún pariente.
Even if I'm not with you and you live somewhere else, I'll call the police and have them do a wellness check on you.
Y si yo no estoy contigo y me doy cuenta de algo así, hasta le puedo llamar a la policía que vaya y chequen si estás bien.
And you can do that. If you're talking to someone, you're not with them, and you're concerned, you haven't heard from them, you know the last conversation you had with them was a little bit dark, you can say, hey, I'm concerned for my cousin, I'm concerned for my friend. Can you have someone go over? And they will send someone.
Y tú puedes hacer eso también. Si la última conversación que tuviste con una persona, notaste que tenían pensamientos muy oscuros y no has tenido contacto con ellos, puedes llamar a las autoridades que vayan a revisar si está bien esa persona.
Here's the thing, the impulse for suicide is often like a roller coaster.
Esta es la cosa, el impulso del suicidio es muchas veces como una montaña rusa.
And what you want to do is help them to be safe in those intense moments when they want to do this thing.
Y lo que quiere hacer es que estén seguros en esos momentos de intensidad donde sienten ganas de hacerlo.
Because they'll get to the other side, but they're not seeing that right now. They're not thinking about that right now, but they will get to the other side.
Porque sí atravesarán al otro lado, o sea, van a pasar por esa etapa, pero no lo ven en ese momento.
So if it's immediate, if they have a plan, if they have weapons, if they have something to do, you want to do everything you can in your power to save their lives.
Así que si tienen armas o los medios para quitarse la vida, quieres hacer todo lo posible para salvarles la vida.
And you want to get other people involved. Create a network of support.
Y quieres involucrar a otras personas, hacer una red de apoyo para esa persona.
You can't do this alone.
No puedes hacerlo tú solo.
Get people that can support you with these individuals. People that they trust. And sometimes even if you have to go outside of that, you need help. Bring others into this thing with you.
Y necesitas buscar a gente que te pueda ayudar, gente a la que esa persona confía. Y si no hay gente en que confía, como quiera, busca otras personas. Tú solo no puedes.
And if you get them through that moment, that situation, continue to follow up with them, check with them. Not a one and done.
Y si los ayudas a atravesar ese momento, como quiera, sigue checándolos. No es de un solo rato. Tienes que continuar revisando a ver si están bien.
And unfortunately, suicide is a complicated thing to deal with. And if you do lose someone, rest assured that you did do everything you could.
Y tristemente el suicidio a veces como quiera suceda, y si llega a pasar, es algo complicado, pero confía en que tú hiciste todo lo posible para ayudar a la persona.
That is a conversation for another day, for the family members, for the friends who survive someone who died by suicide.
Esa es una conversación para otro día, para los miembros de familia y amigos que tienen que lidiar con algo, con que alguien, un ser querido, se quitó la vida.
But it's something that you have to work through and forgive yourself and have peace in yourself that
pero
it happened.
Con lo que tienes que trabajar, tienes que perdonarte. Es algo que sucedió.
And then even with all that you did, it still happened. And
it's not your fault.
Y si a pesar de todos tus esfuerzos por ayudar a la persona, como quiera sucedió, no es tu culpa.
Life is hard.
La vida es difícil.
And we know that God is perfect and God is good and God is all powerful, but life is hard. Life is challenging. And we face many, many difficulties, as Job tells us.
La vida es muy difícil. Tienes que enfrentar muchas dificultades, muchas complicaciones, como nos dice Job.
Suicide is a permanent solution to a temporary problem.
El suicidio es una solución permanente para una situación temporal.
At this time, so everyone has their light. So you have your light.
En este momento todos tienen su lamparita.
Oh, this is yours. I'm taking your light, Oscar. There we go. All right, everyone turn on your light. It's a little bit hard to do on the bottom. There's a switch on the bottom. Just, I already took them out.
Está un poquito duro el switch. Si lo encienden, está en la parte de abajo, es el botoncito negro.
Make sure everyone has their light and it's on. Help your neighbor.
Asegúrense que todos tienen su lamparita encendida.
I'm going to turn off all the lights. Make sure your light is on. All right. All right, everyone has their light.
Todos tienen su lamparita.
This light represents you.
Esta lamparita te representa a ti.
The uniqueness of you that God created you.
Que eres una persona única la que Dios creó.
There's only one version of you.
Solamente hay una versión de ti.
Now I want you to look around the room.
Y quiero que te asomes alrededor de aquí.
If you are a mother, turn off your light.
Si eres una mamá, apaga tu lamparita.
Look around the room. Connect and when a light goes off, it impacts every single one of us.
Fuimos creados para conectarnos y cuando una lamparita se apaga, nos afecta a todos.
If you are a son, turn off your light.
Si eres un hijo, apaga tu lámpara.
Look around the room, it keeps getting darker.
Asómate a tu alrededor y vas a notar que se está poniendo más oscuro.
If you are a husband, turn off your light.
Si eres un esposo, apaga tu lámpara. I was a son first, so I already turned it off.
Yeah, I know. Much darker. If you had a mother or have a mother, turn off your light.
Si eres una madre, apaga tu lámpara.
Have a mother? Or had. Have or had. Yes, that, yeah.
Bueno, si tuviste madre, apaga tu lámpara, pues todos.
It's all dark.
Y está todo oscuro.
When we choose suicide, this is what happens.
Cuando escogemos el suicidio, esto es lo que sucede.
The darkness. You can't be replaced. It affects your family, affects your friends, it affects all of us.
La oscuridad, tú no puedes ser reemplazado, afecta a tus seres queridos, tus amigos, afecta a todos.
Life might be hard, but we need your light to shine. You matter to us.
La vida puede ser difícil, pero necesitamos que tu luz brille. Te necesitamos. Nos importas.
And as I shared last time when we talked about trauma,
y como compartí con ustedes la vez que hablamos del trauma,
that we need to remember this powerful psalm, Psalm 139, verse 12.
Tenemos que recordar este salmo poderoso, el Salmo 139, versículo 12.
Even the darkness is not dark to you.
Aún las tinieblas no encubren de ti.
Depression and suicide might feel overwhelming, overpowering, but we serve a God that is more powerful than suicidal thoughts.
La depresión, el suicidio pueden parecer demasiado fuertes, pero tú tienes un Dios todopoderoso que puede más que el suicidio y la depresión.
In the book of John, when the way John introduces Jesus,
en el libro de Juan, el Evangelio de Juan, la manera en que presenta a Jesús,
he says, I believe it's verse 3, that the light shines in the darkness.
Dice que creo que es el versículo 3 que la luz resplandece en las tinieblas.
But the darkness has not overpowered it.
Y las tinieblas no prevalecieron.
the darkness cannot overpower it.
La oscuridad no puede más que la luz.
Even the darkness will not be dark to the God that you and I serve.
Aún la oscuridad no es oscuridad para el Dios al que tú y yo servimos.
And what does David tell us in Psalms?
¿Y qué nos dice David en los Salmos?
Although I walk through the valley of the shadow of death.
Aunque ande en valle de sombra de muerte.
Because that's what Job says. We're few of days and full of trouble.
Porque eso es lo que dice Job, somos cortos de días y llenos de problemas.
And David echoes Job and said, even when I walk through darkness,
y David dice que aunque atraviese la oscuridad,
you are with me.
Tú estás conmigo.
You may not feel it,
quizás no lo sientas,
but I promise you, in your depression, in your despair, in your wanting to end your life, God is with you.
Pero te prometo que en tu oscuridad, en tu desesperación, Dios está contigo.
He invites us to cast our cares upon him.
Te invita, nos invita a que echemos todos nuestros cuidados sobre él.
Don't be ashamed of these thoughts.
Que no te avergüencen estos pensamientos.
Talk to Jesus about them.
Habla con Jesús de ellos.
Cast your burden.
Echa tu carga.
And he will sustain you. That's a promise.
Y él te sostendrá. Eso es una promesa.
God cares for you. He cares for me.
Le importas mucho a Dios tú y le importo yo.
Even when you fail.
Aún cuando fracasamos.
Even when I've done things I shouldn't do.
Aún cuando he hecho cosas que no debiera.
He still loves me. He still loves you.
Él todavía me ama y todavía te ama a ti.
The voice that wants you to end it all.
La voz que quiere que acabes con todo.
Is the deceiver.
Es del engañador.
The Bible says he is a liar. He's been a liar from the beginning.
La Biblia dice que es un mentiroso desde el principio.
And he continues to lie.
Y continúa mintiendo.
We are created in God's image and he hates us.
Somos creados en la imagen de Dios y él nos odia.
Don't give him that satisfaction.
No le des esa satisfacción.
I found this online and it was just so powerful. It says, suicide does not end the chances of life getting worse. It eliminates the possibility of it ever getting better.
Encontré esta cita en el internet. Dice que el suicidio no termina con las posibilidades de que la vida empeore, sino que elimina la posibilidad de que algún día pueda mejorar.
The story of Job doesn't end with him in despair.
La historia de Job no termina con él en la desesperación.
Job survived his suicidal thoughts.
Job sobrevivió sus pensamientos suicidas.
And Job says, I know my Redeemer lives.
Y Job dice, yo sé que mi Redentor vive.
And though my body be destroyed,
y aunque mi cuerpo sea deshecho,
though this diagnosis is eating away at me,
aunque este diagnosis me está matando,
though my finances are horrible,
aunque mis finanzas estén horribles,
though I have lost everything,
aunque haya perdido todo,
I know that he lives, and in my flesh I will see God.
Yo sé que mi Redentor vive y en mi carne he de ver a Dios.
Don't give in to that darkness.
No te rindas a esa oscuridad.
There's a well-known story about this lady, Miss Johnson.
Hay una historia muy conocida de la señora Johnson,
who needed heart surgery.
Que necesitaba una operación del corazón.
And she goes in to have the procedure.
Y cuando va a que le hagan el procedimiento,
and top surgeon, and he and his team did the job, did it well.
Y el mejor cirujano, él y su equipo hicieron el trabajo y lo hicieron muy bien.
And at the end of the procedure, he started to try to restart her heart.
Y al final del procedimiento trató de encender, de reiniciar el corazón.
So at first he gently massages the heart.
Así que empieza a hacerle unos masajes leves.
It doesn't start.
Y no revive.
So, you know, he's doesn't know what's going on. The repairs have been done. It should start back, but it's not starting up.
Y no sabe qué es lo que está sucediendo. Se hizo todo correctamente, pero pues no quiere arrancar.
And he tries other more aggressive things to get the heart to start up again.
Y empieza a tratar otras cosas más agresivas para que empiece a latir el corazón.
Finally, he decides to talk to the lady.
Finalmente decide empezar a hablar con la señora.
Says, Miss Johnson, this is your surgeon.
Le dice, señora Johnson, yo soy su cirujano.
It's done. We've made the repairs.
Ya hicimos toda la reparación.
Everything is done. Everything is ready.
Todo está listo.
You just need to tell your heart to breathe again.
Usted nada más tiene que decirle a su corazón que lata de nuevo.
The heart began to beat.
Y empezó a latir el corazón.
Brothers and sisters, life is hard.
Hermanos, hermanas, la vida es difícil.
And from time to time or all the time we grapple with some mental health challenge.
Y de vez en cuando vamos a atravesar algún reto mental.
Even to the point of wanting to end our lives.
Al punto a veces de querer quitarnos la vida.
Just picture Jesus saying to you.
Nada más imagínate a Jesús diciéndote.
I came so that you can have life.
Yo vine para que tú tengas vida.
Now tell your heart to beat again.
Ahora dile a tu corazón que empiece a latir de nuevo.
Tell your darkness, tell your depression, tell your negative thoughts to have life and joy and hope again.
Dile a tu oscuridad, a tu depresión, a tus pensamientos oscuros que empiece a tener gozo de nuevo.
In a little while my daughter is going to sing a song, but before we do that, you all have a scroll, which I don't have my scroll. We need scrolls, please.
En un momentito, mi hija va a cantar una canción, pero antes de eso, deben de tener un rollito.
All right, I want you to open your scroll.
Quiero que abran su rollito.
I want you to preserve this. It's very special, very fancy paper.
Quiero que lo preserven. Es muy especial.
And we do have some in Spanish, so if you need one in Spanish, we do have those.
Y si lo tenemos en español, si necesitan un español, se lo podemos hacer llegar.
So we're going to sign this covenant.
Vamos a firmar este pacto con Dios.
Covenant is a pact, and what we're going to do is I'm going to read through it.
Lo que vamos a hacer es que lo voy a leer.
Actually, let's read it together. Let's all stand.
Vamos a pararnos todos y lo vamos a leer todos juntos.
All right, make sure you have a pen. We do have pens available. We do have extra, so if you want to bring some home, give to your friends, family members, feel free to do that. We do have some extras. Okay, let's begin. My covenant with God.
Mi pacto con Dios.
And my brothers and sisters in Christ.
Y mis hermanos y hermanas en Cristo.
Because I am fearfully and wonderfully made.
Porque soy maravillosamente creado.
I covenant with God today, April 20th, 2024.
Hoy convengo con Dios el día 20 de abril 2024.
To love my life and preserve it.
Amar mi vida y preservarla.
Even in the most difficult times.
Aún en las situaciones más difíciles.
I also promise to be a safe space.
También prometo ser un espacio seguro.
For any of my brothers and sisters who are struggling with their mental health.
Para cualquiera de mis hermanos y hermanas que están luchando contra con su salud mental.
And let's go ahead and sign, and you can have a seat.
Pueden firmar y tomar asiento.
You can put it back in your ribbon. Make sure you keep it.
Pueden guardar de nuevo y quedarse con él.
At this time, we'll have an appeal song, and then our pastor will do a special prayer for us.
Ahora vamos a tener una canción que es un llamado, y luego nuestro pastor va a tener una oración por nosotros.
Tell your heart to beat again. Close your eyes and breathe it in. Let the shadows fall away. Step into the light of grace. Yesterday's a closing door. You don't live there anymore. Say goodbye to where you've been and tell your heart to beat again. Your heart to beat again.
For so God loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, so that whoever believes in him should not perish. Porque Dios amó tanto al mundo que dio a su Hijo unigénito para que todo aquel que en él crea no perezca, but instead they shall have eternal life. Pero en vez recibirán la vida eterna. I invite everybody to please kneel with me at this moment as we pray at this time. Les invito a que se arrodillen conmigo para orar en este momento. Father, our life on earth has been difficult and harsh. Padre, nuestra vida aquí en la tierra ha sido difícil y dura. We have suffered. We have experienced pain and loss. Hemos sufrido y experimentado dolor y pérdida. And many of us, Lord, have at times perhaps questioned the value of our life. Y quizá hemos cuestionado, Padre, el valor de nuestra vida. But you have told us that our lives are so valuable to you. Pero nos has dicho que nuestras vidas son tan valiosas para ti. That you would not even hold back your own life to save us. Que no retuviste tu propia vida para salvarnos. There are many, Lord, in this group, in this room right now, who have wrestled with the value of their life. Muchos en este cuarto quizá han estado batallando con el valor de su vida. Many people who are watching online may have done the battle, Lord, as well. Muchos que están viendo en línea posiblemente han batallado con esto también. And then there's countless others who will watch this recording in the future who have been or will be battling with this. Y hay muchos que han de ver este video en el futuro que están ahora o habrán de estar batallando con esto. But Father, at this moment, we pray and ask and come before you on our knees and beg you, Lord, let your light break through the darkness of our lives. Permite, Señor, te pedimos de rodillas, imploramos, permite que tu luz rompa la oscuridad en nuestras vidas. That we may be able to rise again to a life and life eternal with you. Que podamos levantarnos, Señor, a una vida eterna contigo. That we may become victorious, Lord, over the struggles of this life. Que podamos ser victoriosos sobre los problemas de esta vida. I pray specifically now, Lord, for those who are dealing with this right now. Pido, Señor, por aquellos que están luchando con esto en este momento. Use us to other brethren to help them see your light. Ayúdanos, Señor, a que ellos puedan ver la luz por medio de nosotros. Help us, Father, love them as you do. Ayúdanos a amarlos como tú lo haces. That each and every one of us may be your agents to save lives. Que podamos ser tus agentes para salvar vidas. Bring them strength, Lord. Dales fuerza. Bring them joy, Lord. Dales gozo. Transform their sorrow into dancing. Cambia, Señor, su lamento en alabanza. Te suplico, Señor, que tu bendición, tu poder, tu amor los cubra en cada momento. Let your power, your provision, your love cover and surround them in every moment. We claim victory in your name. Clamamos ya victoria en tu nombre. Knowing that no matter how dark things may get, darkness is not dark to you. Sabiendo que sin importar qué tan oscuro sea, la oscuridad no es oscura para ti. We praise you for your love. Te adoramos por tu amor. Be with us, Lord, as we may depart from this room. Sé con nosotros a que nos retiramos de este cuarto. Be with us as this broadcast may end. Sé con nosotros aún si esta producción puede terminar. But we know that your love and care for us will never depart, will never end. Sabemos nosotros que tu amor por nosotros nunca se desvanecerá, nunca terminará. In the name of Jesus, we come to you. En el nombre de Jesús, venimos a ti. Amen. I am, huh? You can keep your lights. Pueden quedarse con las luces. I'm very thankful that Brother Rommel has been sharing these topics with us. Estoy muy agradecido con nuestro hermano Rommel que ha estado compartiendo estos temas con nosotros. This afternoon will be the last presentation. Esta tarde va a ser la última presentación. You may want to log in once again at 6 p.m. this afternoon. Si están en línea, pueden reconectarse a las 6 esta tarde. And everybody here in the room is welcome to be here as well. Todos los que están presentes son bienvenidos a estar acá. Thank you. May God bless you. He is with you today, tomorrow, and always. Que el Señor les bendiga. Gracias por estar acá. El Señor está contigo hoy, mañana y siempre. May you all have a blessed and happy Sabbath. Que todos tengan un sábado bendecido.